Emerging out of the embers of Joy Division, New Order spent the 1980s smashing together the worlds of punk and disco. In 1983, they gave the world a shuddering party starter that took elements from black gay club music, Giorgio Moroder, Kraftwerk, spaghetti westerns, and British melancholy. Such a revolution in sound that Blue Monday, perhaps, became the biggest selling 12-inch single of all time. Only perhaps, because the myths surrounding Blue Monday are belligerent and numerous, impeded by each member of the band having conflicting accounts of their 1980s. Many of the rumours and legends about the song are provably wrong, and yet still persist. It may be the song to get indie kids to the dance floor, but what do we really know about this 7.5-minute groove automaton? This is New British Canon, and this is the story of Blue Monday. On Sunday, 18th of May, 1980, Ian Curtis hung himself. The band he fronted, Joy Division, were on the edge of mainstream acceptance. With a new album recorded, their first US tour booked, and soon to be canonized anthem, Love Will Tear Us Apart, in their back pocket. Losing their messianic frontman, the band's surviving members, drummer Stephen Morris, guitarist Bernard Sumner, and bassist Peter Hook, numbly continued on as New Order, weeks after his passing. I think there was a fear that if we didn't do something quickly, everything would fade away. Which wasn't true. It was an excuse. How we coped with grief. But I must admit, it worked. Though U2's Bono reportedly offered, the band felt that no one could replace Curtis, and so they initially all shouldered the vocal load. To fill in the musical gap, they employed Gillian Gilbert on keyboards and guitar. Previously, she'd played a show with Joy Division, playing guitar in place of Curtis, who'd injured his hand. But part of the allure was her inexperience. I think they wanted someone without any knowledge of guitar whatsoever, to remind them of when they started and couldn't play. I think they were also looking for somebody who didn't have any particular style, so they could work them better into the band. Part of what fueled New Order was a punk aversion to rockstar pretensions. They avoided self-promotion, rarely gave interviews, and when they played live, they refused to play their old band songs, and never played encores. We believe that after 40 minutes or so of our music, people wanted something else, so we'd play for about that long, then bugger off. It never crossed our mind that not everyone thought the same way. We thought we were doing people a favour. Various shows would end in riots, those in attendance feeling ripped off by their condensed performances. Because of this, one show in Rotterdam ended in a barrage of beer bottles and fists.
We played for 21 minutes. There was no security. The audience went ape. We were bad as well. And they started throwing things. So the crew got involved and they were throwing things at the crew and the crew were throwing them back. Then it turned into a big fight on the floor and my mate, the sound guy, was getting beaten. So I jumped off to help him. When I jumped off, they all went, oh, he's out of the band. And they all jumped on me like a rugby scrum. And one of them punched me and knocked me out. And the roadies had to come out with dustbins and beat the people off.
The shadow of Ian Curtis and Joy Division loomed. New Order's first single, released by their previous band's label, Factory, consisted of a couple of unreleased Joy Division songs. This is why writing new material would be a challenge, as they had never written songs without Curtis as orchestrator, telling them what parts of songs were worth keeping. Their first releases were also produced by Factory's in-house mastermind, Martin Hannett, making New Order's first LP, Movement, sound more like a continuation than a new direction. We had such a tough time making Movement, emotionally, because of Martin. He was grieving and getting heavily into drugs. He'd lock himself in a room with a gram of coke and say, if I hear anything I like, I'll come out. And not come out. It was such a kick in the balls. After playing some shows in New York through 1980 and 81, the band got a taste for the city's nightlife. But most importantly, the music coming from the likes of Danceteria and the Peppermint Lounge.
Tonight, I'll be real.
It led to an epiphany. Why couldn't a post-punk group from Manchester be the ones making people dance? As well as investing in the factory-helmed Manchester club, the Hacienda, New Order's music was becoming more and more electronic and kinetic. It wasn't completely at odds with what Joy Division might have become. Curtis had been obsessed with the rhythmic early 70s German bands, especially Kraftwerk. Showroom dummies. We are showroom dummies. While the 1980 12-inch version of She's Lost Control was an exploratory attempt at an extended disco mix. However, to make the first step, they needed some new kit. The equipment was hideously expensive, so we made our own from electronic kits with a soldering iron. If it didn't work well, we'd rebuild it. It was very crude. I remember the drum machine we used worked fine until you shone a torch at it. Then it froze. With a purchase of a Boss DR55 Dr. Rhythm drum machine, as well as Sumner's self-soldered Transcendent 2000 synthesizer, New Order's first experiment in all things dance was Everything's Gone Green from December 1981. By plugging their synth into their drum machine, Morris was able to conjure a synthetic, rhythmic thrum as percussion, effectively making himself obsolete. At the time, I remember having a crisis of confidence. The drum machine's ability to stay in time with the synth it controlled, no matter what, began to annoy me. Smug mechanical bastard. Acoustic drums would be added, but sadly it would be the last straw for Martin Hannett. Him leaving the studio during mixing, after Morris asked them to be turned up. Continuing with the experimentation, the fidgety sentimentality of Temptation was inspired by Giorgio Moroder's work on Sparks's number one song in Heaven. With the band self-producing for the first time, the May 1982 single jangled and pulsed in equal measure, a perfect collision of their past and future. It was really when Joy Division fans didn't like what we were doing, like with Everything's Gone Green and Temptation, that we knew we'd hit on something. In October 1982, New Order moved to London to record in Pink Floyd's Britannia Row studio, the same studio they'd recorded Movement and Joy Division's Closer. But this time, for New Order's second album, Martin Hannett wasn't at the helm. Producing Power, Corruption and Lies ourselves was very much a new beginning. That's not just hindsight, it felt like a fresh start at the time. New Order were becoming a little gang of our own, going further away from Joy Division. Morris says the title Power, Corruption and Lies was poached from the blurb on the back of a copy of George Orwell's Animal Farm, though Hook, in an instance of doublethink, believes it was 1984. Several songs including Ultraviolence and We All Stand had been written during the Movement sessions, but after the quantum leaps forward of Everything's Gone Green and Temptation, they now seemed outdated. We'd written a few songs on clunky old drum machines and sequences. Once we got the new equipment, we basically wrote them again. 5/8/6 was always a loose jam. Then Bernard turned it into something else when he came up with the Giorgio Moroder style dark intro. The technology really wasn't that great. Space Invaders machines had better tech. More interested in being in a rock and roll band rather than messing around with solder and wires. Peter Hook pushed back against New Order, becoming a fully synthetic group. Opener Age of Consent and Closer Leave Me Alone are them at their most jangle pop, with Hook's warm, melodically inclined bass lines showing the band's humanity. Won't you By this point, Sumner was firmly in the lead singer role, despite the unpolished nature of his vocals. He also took over the majority of lyric writing, but deadline anxiety and chemical assistance were the main ways Sumner was able to conjure words, drunkenly taking to the stage, ad-libbing to the new songs, before listening back and keeping anything the band liked. Temptations' chorus had been the result of a quarter tab of acid taken before soundcheck. In the studio, Bernard had found this old white lab coat on the back of a door that he insisted on wearing while he worked. "I look like a mad scientist," he said. Every day he took tiny little slithers of an acid tab that he said opened him up. The album's centerpiece is Your Silent Face, a stately ballad beset by synth violins. The original title, KW1, alludes to the bouncy synth pulse's clear Kraftwerk influence. But its kiss-off lyrics show the band's Mancunian humour and Sumner's unwillingness to go the obvious route. So we put down a quite nice vocal line and some nice lyrics.
No hearing or breathing.
But by the end, we got stuck for a couple of lines. Everyone was thinking of really beautiful, poetic, meaningless lyrics. Then I thought, instead of having something beautiful, poetic, and meaningless, we might as well have something dumb, idiotic, coarse, and meaningless. An absolute contrast to the rest. Even roses have thorns. But most of their time in the studio was spent working really hard to be really lazy. The initial idea behind Blue Monday was so that they had a definitive answer to their no encores policy. To quell potential riots, why not have an encore that played itself? With all their interest in electronic hardware, surely that was now possible. Just imagine if we connected them all together, walk on, press a button, leave the gear to play a song all on its own, while we piss off back to the booze in the dressing room and chortle to ourselves. An invisible band. It'd be a laugh, and we like nothing better than a good laugh. We'd be doing an encore and not doing one at the same time. Elements of Blue Monday emerged from their first experiment with the Oberheim DMX drum machine, the completely electronic 20-minute instrumental Video 586, programmed earlier in 1982. Enjoying the fullness of the DMX's FUD, Morris would fashion Blue Monday's iconic stuttering stomp, mimicking the pattern present on the Giorgio Moroder produced Our Love by Donna Summer. But such new and finicky hardware brought its own problems. To back up his work, Morris would have to copy it onto a spare tape. But upon doing this for the first time, it wiped what he'd written. And when he tried to play the tape back, all he got was the LED display flashing back bad data. He would have to start over. Peter Hook challenges this story, believing the first version of Blue Monday going missing was pure clumsiness on Morris's part. Him simply kicking the mains lead out at an inopportune moment. When he reprogrammed the DMX, they recorded the beat by playing it through the studio monitor, capturing the natural reverb of Britannia Row's cavernous rooms, increasing each kick's impact. But Ghost in the Drum Machine weren't the only blunder that lent Blue Monday its character. The synthesizer melody is slightly out of sync with the rhythm. This was an accident. It was my job to program the entire song from beginning to end, which had to be done manually by inputting every note. I had the sequence all written down on loads of A4 paper, sellotaped together the length of the recording studio, like a huge knitting pattern, but I accidentally left a note out. which skewed the melody. One of the other new toys they had recently acquired was the EMU Emulator 1, while hardly affordable to most upcoming synth punks. With factory footing the several thousand pound bill, New Order had access to one of the earliest commercial samplers, able to record and play back up to 4 seconds of sound via the attached keyboard. Such important advancements in electronic wizardry would be handled with the requisite reverence. Within a few minutes, we'd sampled our first fart. Had you been there, I'm sure you would have done the same. In laddish glee, we fell about laughing hysterically. Samples of the inevitable puerile swearing phrases like "f off" and "you twats" soon followed. The emulator was a winner on so many levels. It opened up a world of creative possibilities. Jillian was not too impressed. The emulator would be used to sample thunder, as well as the ghostly choir taken from Kraftwerk's Uranium. With a synthesized Moog bass line, written with club classic "You Make Me Feel Mighty Real" by Sylvester Remind. Hook was adamant that he wouldn't be left out like he had been on 586 video. Having freshly caught the Sergio Leone Western for a few dollars more on TV, he added his own Ennio Morricone style flourish. All the pieces came together in a rough around the edges hole. There was definitely an awkwardness about Blue Monday, but that's what made it so strong. At that time, I was really influenced by Italian disco records. There were two scenes at that time. American dance music, which was slick and dead professional. That didn't appeal to me as it was so polished. It was boring. The Italian stuff was funny because you'd hear the bad mistakes, and that gave the songs character. One other influence that some people are keen to point out is Jerry and the Holograms' 1979 self-titled song. A situationist Manchester group attempting to parody the first wave of synth pop. Their titular track is said to be reminiscent of New Order's Revolution Starter. Not that Sumner knows anything about that. Never heard of them. Never ever, I swear on my life. There were influences on Blue Monday, but that wasn't one of them. I can tell you from the bottom of my heart. No, it's just not true. If it was, I'd admit it. Originally, Morris planned to add a robotic voice for vocals, but it allegedly sounded like a rapping Dalek. Everyone hated it, and his progress ended up getting accidentally erased. Sumner ended up singing on the track, albeit infrequently. Though the track is 7.5 minutes long, his voice doesn't appear until over 2 minutes in. And it lacks a traditional chorus. Though Hook is convinced that the words are meaningless, and fans have speculated its naval theming might be a reference to the contemporaneous Falklands conflict. Supposedly, it's much more simple than that. He says the lyric came about because he was fed up with journalists asking him how he felt. The lines about the beach and the harbour were the start of his many nautical references. He loves sailing. Like many things about the creation of Blue Monday, how it got its name is contentious. hook feels like they stole it from the Fats Domino song of the same name.
Blue Monday, how are you, Blue Monday?
While Morris and Gilbert believe it was taken from the alternative title of the Kurt Vonnegut book, Breakfast of Champions, Goodbye, Blue Monday. In the book's reality, it's a slogan for a washing machine company, with the intent to improve the lives of housewives with their automatic washers. Thematically, Blue Monday, the song, was doing exactly the same thing, automating the process of dance music. However, by this point, and with unprogrammable human elements, Blue Monday was no longer purely a joke at their audience's expense. Their manager, Rob Gretton, was so excited about the track's potential that it prompted him to strip off and dance around the control room. Perhaps it could be a hit, an era-defining single, but there was one hurdle remaining. We'd spent a lot of time getting it perfect in the studio, but then we went to Australia and had to figure out how the fuck we were going to play it in front of paying customers. Bernard swore blind it was impossible, which kind of spurs you on a little bit. That was actually harder than recording it. Figuring out how to play it live. That was where the acid wore off.
Kicking off with New Order, playing live, singing live with Blue Monday.
Blue Monday was released as a single in March 1983, 2 months before the Power, Corruption and Lies LP. Because the song wouldn't fit on a standard 7-inch single, the decision was made to issue it on the disco format of choice, the 12-inch. It was packaged in the infamous Peter Saville design sleeve, inspired by the fascinating new storage medium that was supplying the Emulator 1 with its sound library. I'd been up to see the band in the studio and heard this track that was made using technology, and there was a floppy disk lying around in the studio. I asked if I could borrow it, and when I was driving home realized it would be a good visual image for the record, as New Order didn't want the track to be cut down into a more manageable form. It was effectively barred from daytime radio. Despite this, the week after its release, it entered the UK singles chart at number 37 and was climbing. Because of this, BBC's flagship music chart program, Top of the Pops, wanted them to appear to promote the song. But the issue of punk rock ethics again intruded. The Clash never appeared on Top of the Pops, and the show's requisite miming policy was to be rallied against when you were a band that could indeed play live. 3 times they asked the band before the BBC agreed to New Order's terms. They would appear, but only if they could play the track live. Problem was, they had only just about learned how to play the track live, and they would now be playing a specially cropped version. During rehearsal, the camera operators realized that the band, Peter Hook aside, were barely moving. Gilbert and Morris especially waiting patiently for their cue to perfectly trigger the sequences. Come showtime, they not only barely moved, but they sounded awful as well. The Top of the Pop studio wasn't set up for live sound. Hook's bass was aggressively twangy. Sumner's vocals squeaked with nerves.
How does it feel when you treat me like you do?
And Morris's washing machine dreams had become a nightmare. So in awe was I of the glamour of the situation, I fed the floppies in the wrong order. Instead of the mighty thunderclap I and the rest of the band were expecting, out came a wimpy choir going "ah" instead. Broadcast on the 31st of March, the band laughed off their shambolic playthrough, reframing their disaster as a statement of punk chaos. Normally, when a band appears on Top of the Pops, there would be a spike in sales from exposure, and the single would rise the next week. Legend has it that Blue Monday fell 10 places after their performance, but according to the official charts website, it did ascend, from number 17 to number 14, gaining 3. It would peak in October at number 9. They did return to Top of the Pops in May 1984, with Thieves Like Us, again playing live. On that occasion, the song dropped the next week by 4 places. This is probably where the confusion lies. Blue Monday would remain in the UK charts until December, 8 months after its release, but would re-enter periodically in the years to come. One aspect that allowed the song to remain chart relevant was Mediterranean party islands like Ibiza, where the song was a staple floor filler. Returning to Britain, the young holidaymakers would relive their memories by going out and buying the 12-inch in its iconic sleeve. Because of its continued sales, it ended up becoming the best-selling 12-inch of all time. Maybe. Because New Order were on factory records, this could never be officially proven by the British phonographic industry. It sold loads and loads of copies, but we didn't get any awards for it. Being on a small independent label, we weren't members of the relevant societies. So when it hit 500,000, Tony Wilson made up a special Factory Records Award. This big cogwheel that was almost like a hammer and sickle. I've still got it, actually. It weighs a ton. Another extremely entertaining New Order myth is that due to label oversight and the expense of the sleeve design, they lost money on each copy sold, which as it supposedly became the best-selling 12-inch single of all time, is very funny. It lost 10p on every copy, because there were three different holes on it, stamped out by three different machines. It cost a mint. And what Steve Morris always loves about it was not the bits you bought on Blue Monday that cost the money. It was the bits you didn't get. The holes. The truth is much more boring. After getting the invoice back from the first pressing of Blue Monday, they realized their mistake, and so later pressings had the cost-saving, holeless sleeve. But as factory head Tony Wilson famously said, itself paraphrased from a line in The Man Who Shot Liberty Valance, "When you have to choose between the truth and the legend, print the legend." But again, there is a good chance he probably didn't say that. But Steve Coogan playing him in 24-hour Party People, the source for a lot of factory folklore, most definitely did.
When you have to choose between the truth and the legend, print the legend.
As the 80s advanced, so did New Order, moving further away from the morbid post-punk of their former band. 1985's Low Life and 1986's Brotherhood would not only advance their hybrid guitar electronica, but would also gain them footing in the US. This led to a surprising offer from the orange-flavoured soft drink brand, Sunkist, who wanted to sell their product using Blue Monday with altered lyrics. As the paragon of punk credibility, manager Rob Gretton was away and therefore unable to stop them, the band attempted to cash in on this massive payday. They originally told us they wanted to use Blue Monday and we thought, fine, great. So then they said, right, when are you going to do this voiceover? Voiceover? We tried singing the changed lyrics and we started rolling around on the floor. They were offering us a fortune, but the cringe part of it was just too heavy. Depending on who you want to believe, the story either ends here. Gretton got word and said, no, you're not doing that.
How important has Rob Gretton been?
Well, he stopped us doing Sunkist advert, which was a shame because we got offered, I think it was $200,000 to use the music for Blue Monday, but exchange the lyrics with ones that were flattering towards their particular soft drink.
Or, if you take Peter Hook's word, Sunkist somehow acquired an instrumental version of Blue Monday and affixed the shaky redub takes. The Sunkist ad ran a few times in the US before the New Order camp realized what happened. The ad was taken off the air, but the band never got paid. In his book Substance Inside New Order, Peter Hook claims you can watch that ad on YouTube. But you can't, because the ad never existed. The version on YouTube is a mock-up of what the ad might have looked and sounded like, made especially for the eccentric 1983 documentary, The New Order Story.
Go and make a cup of tea, drop an E, come back in 2 minutes. Thank you very much indeed.
How does it feel?
The fake ad's footage is just a crude assembly of Sunkist's then contemporary Drinking the Sun series of ads.
Drinking in the sun, Sunkist is the one.
And New Order's Touched by the Hand of God video.
When you're drinking in the sunshine, Sunkist is the one.
But the 90s VHS quality of the uploads make it look legit. So legit that Hook believes it actually happened.
On Drink It In, Sunkist, regular or diet.
When you need taste for living.
Or he just wants to perpetuate an entertaining half-truth. I love the myths around the song. There was the one about Dave Stewart, who'd spent ages recording a Eurythmics album, then heard Blue Monday, and started all over again. The story how the song was inspired by a suicide pact of Swedish students who'd been listening to Fats Domino's Blue Monday. I like that one. Midway through the 80s, their music was licensed by US super producer Quincy Jones for his Quest label. This would eventually lead, in 1988, to Jones remixing the track for a 7-inch single release, what was known as Blue Monday 88. He did a very safe job on the Blue Monday remix. We're all very happy with it, and we took the fact that it sounded so similar to the original as a great compliment to our own production skills. Even the great Quincy Jones couldn't improve on it. In the UK, Blue Monday 88 would end up surpassing the original's peak chart performance, scaling to number 3, with the only singles ahead of it being Fairground Attraction's Perfect at number 1. It's got to be perfect. And Theme from S-Express by S-Express at 2. The previous week, S-Express, part of a new vanguard of British DIY acid house, had been at number 1, an achievement that wouldn't have been possible without New Order and Blue Monday's groundwork. Influence-wise, the effect was pretty much immediate. Within months of its 1983 release, artists and bands were putting out their own semi-automated dance machines, heavily inspired by Blue Monday. Pet Shop Boys' Neil Tennant was reportedly nearly in tears upon hearing New Order's song for the first time. So close was it to the song that he and Chris Lowe were planning to release.
I always remember it was called Keeping My Fingers Crossed. I'm keeping my fingers crossed. Do, 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 do. And I thought, they've just done it. They've done it. Because this was really gay dance music. And I thought, how can these Mancunian heterosexuals know about this? They've beaten us to it. It was quite a big moment.
In the same way that New Order had taken from gay dance and Italo disco, those genres would also be inspired by the rigid, thumping beats and sparseness of Blue Monday, as well as the commercial viability of 12-inch mixes. It preempted techno, acid house, Manchester and dance punk, and set a template for Daft Punk, The Chemical Brothers, Robin, LCD Sound System, Hot Chip, Churches and M83, to name a few. The guys they were ripping off, Kraftwerk, even planned to hire out Britannia Row to get the Blue Monday sound for a reworking of their August 1983 single, Tour de France. Though they worked with New Order's sound engineer, Michael Johnson, the remix was never used. An alternate version of the story, again from Peter Hook, is that Kraftwerk took one look at Britannia Row, thought someone must have been f***ing with them, and left. It seems the German foursome assumed that New Order's high-tech electro dance 12-inch couldn't have possibly been recorded in somewhere so traditional. Said Hook, I took that as quite a compliment. But beyond electronic music, the impact of Blue Monday persists. Blur's Girls and Boys drum machine beats and disco bassline satirizing summer clubbers. Kylie Minogue performing her mega hit, Can't Get You Out of My Head, at the 2002 Brits, with an all too familiar backing. And because of an interpolation, the band receiving a writing credit on Rihanna's Shut Up and Drive. And that's not to mention all the covers, spanning every genre. How does it feel to treat me like you do? When you laid your hand upon me, I'm torn. But really, the greatest influence Blue Monday has had is being an invitation to move. A dance floor filler that defies genre, era, race, and sexuality. Essentially, it was a machine to facilitate dancing. As a song, I wouldn't say it's my favourite New Order track, but as a prompt to make you dance, it's unsurpassed. Even today, more than three decades later, when Blue Monday comes on in a club, people get straight up and on the floor. It still cuts it. So how does it feel? I really don't know. You'll have to ask each member of New Order individually to find out. Thanks for watching. What's your favourite tall tale about New Order or Blue Monday? Comment down below. If you like this video, like, subscribe, and why don't you also do me a favour and share it with a couple of people. It really does help. As always, I'd like to shout out my new top tier supporters over on Patreon. Buckley Planet, Q-Dot, Luntosis, Rhino, and Teo. And thanks again to all that support me. And I'll see you hopefully in 3 weeks' time for some more British electropop.